turns my way. When sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. It is Christ that I live. When danger around me shall roll, no fear shall be mine, for in death as in life, Christ will whisper his peace to my soul, my soul. But Lord, 'tis for thee, for thy coming we wait. The sky, not the grave, is our goal. The trumpet shall sound, so it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well.
Good afternoon. My name is Pastor Eric Gaynor, and I serve here at Holy Trinity Lutheran Church. On behalf of myself, our associate pastor, Emily Ebert, and our congregation, I want to thank you and welcome you into this space, and thank you for your support of Shirley's family this afternoon. It is our honor to be hosting this memorial. We recognize that Shirley was involved in many congregations over the years, including here at Holy Trinity, just around the corner from her home, where she attended many functions, especially those celebrating her family and grandchildren who participated in activities here. As we prepare now to begin our service today, I want to just give a few reminders. First of all, we ask you to silence those cell phones and electronic devices you might have with you. For those new to this location, just to let you know, the bathrooms are immediately to your right, just as you go outside of the sanctuary doors. We also want to welcome all those watching on the live stream today or at a future date. We are glad you can also be present with us in this way. Please note, however, that due to copyright laws, the live stream will go silent just for a little while during the remembrance video. After the service is over, you are all invited to join the family immediately following the service for a reception and food. It'll be just outside these big glass doors, then all the way down to the glass doors on your right. That, too, you might say, is also a sacred time, as more memories and more stories are shared. As many of you know, Shirley and her family have been involved in the wider church, both here in Southern California and across the country, especially during her husband's tenure as a bishop. Because of this, we want to lift up some special guests who are with us today who have also been involved in leadership with the wider church. First of all, we have Bishop Jeff Johnson with us from Sierra Pacific Synod, who will be helping to lead the service today. We also have with us former Bishop Dean Nelson, who I hear is celebrating his 80th birthday. Are you here, Dean? All right. Happy birthday to you. We also have Mary Wenis, widow of Bishop Howie Wenis, who is with us over here. Hi. And former Bishop Michael Niels and his wife, Mary, who are over here. Thank you. In addition, there are three other bishops who send their greetings. Bishop Brenda Boss, current bishop of the Southwest California Synod, who will have a letter read later in the service. Bishop Dave Nagler, the Pacifica Synod, who was planning to be here, woke up sick just this morning, though, so wasn't able to attend. And also former Bishop Murray Fink and his wife, Rhoda. I want to point out that in the back of the bulletin, you'll also see a beautiful letter from Shirley's Pastor B. Chun. The letter is in addition an invitation for a service that will conclude with the placement of Shirley's ashes at St. Francis Lutheran in San Francisco on Sunday, May 5th, 11 a.m. Finally, you will note that there are three candles here on the altar today, in addition to the altar candles. These are to acknowledge three other deaths that have happened in the extended family since Shirley has died. Before we continue with this service, I'd like to acknowledge and name these three loved ones. One candle is for Richard Branson, father of Karen Egertson. Richard's widow, Diane, is with us today. The second candle is for Jerry Branson, Karen's aunt, sister to Richard. And the third candle is for Gordon Cheesewright, who died just this week and is married to a cousin, Diane. I now invite you to rise in body or in spirit and turn towards our baptismal font to begin our service led by Pastor Jim Boleen.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy, the God of all consolation. We are gathered to worship, to proclaim Christ crucified and risen, to remember before God our beloved Shirley May, and to give thanks for her life, to commend her to our merciful Redeemer, and to comfort one another in our grief.
All who are baptized into Christ have put on Christ. In her baptism, Shirley was clothed with Christ. In the day of Christ's coming, she shall be clothed with glory.
Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, who formed us from the dust of the earth, who by your breath gave us life, we glorify you.
We glorify you. Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, who suffered death for all humanity, who rose from the grave to open the way to eternal life, we praise you.
We praise you.
Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, the comforter of all who sorrow, our sure confidence and everlasting hope, we worship you.
We worship you.
To you, O blessed Trinity, be honor and glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
The grace of our Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty God, source of all mercy and giver of comfort, we remember before you today our beloved Shirley Mae Smith Egertson. We thank you for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn, so that casting all our sorrow on you, we may know the consolation of your love. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
A reading from the prophet Micah. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? Word of God, word of life.
A reading from Paul's letter to the church in Rome. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the Spirit, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to God's purpose. For those whom God foreknew, God also predestined to be conformed to the image of the Son, in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom God predestined, God also called. And those whom God called, God also justified. And those whom God justified, God also glorified.
What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? God, who did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for all of us, will God not with him also give up everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died. Yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
I'm Vivian Johnson, and I'm a part of the extended family. I'm so pleased to be here. Shirley and I met 62 years ago. We were both young women married to Lutheran pastors. My husband, George Johnson, was ordained that day in April of 1962 at St. Timothy Lutheran Church in Lakewood. Shirley and Paul attended the service. And then they came to the reception following the service. That's when I met Shirley. I thought, what a lovely woman. Years later, Shirley's son, Steve, and my daughter, Sonia, were married. Sonia was the first young woman to enter that Egertson family of six young men. Paul and Shirley were delighted. They had a girl. They opened their hearts and their home to Sonia, and did I ever appreciate that. From that point on, the bond between Shirley and I began to strengthen, and it continued to do so throughout the years. An indication of our deep friendship is that even though Sonia and Steve are no longer married, the love and the friendship between the Egertson and the Johnson families remains. Now that's true friendship. When I think of Shirley, I think of creative. Her selection of clothing was creative in that her appearance sometimes had an ethereal quality to it. I remember on one occasion, I believe it was a clergy family picnic. Most of us were in our standard picnic clothing, like shorts and t-shirts. But then Shirley arrived. She floated across the grass in a wispy long dress with winged sleeves that were carried by the breeze. She was a vision of loveliness. In her hands was a dish to share that was not only delicious, but the presentation was artistic, just like its maker. Shirley's creativity included a specialized type of painting called Norwegian rosemaling, and since I'm Norwegian and Swedish, I thought it was especially beautiful. And if you walked through Shirley's home and her gardens, you'd again notice her creative touch. It was everywhere. And oh, I envied her musical talent. She was a violinist, a soloist, and a choir director. But you must be told that she was shy. She was very poised when she was performing, but she told me she did not like to speak in front of a group. She did not even feel comfortable walking up for communion. She was very shy. Of course, we can't forget that her creativity was at its best when she and Paul created six sons of good looks and many talents. Every autumn for about 20 years, Shirley and I were part of a foursome that traveled to Solvang for a weekend. Shirley and I were roommates, and it was there that our friendship reached its deepest level. We talked, we laughed, we cried, we confided in each other. I'll not forget the time when in Solvang, Shirley purchased a large birdhouse. I think it was a church birdhouse. And attached to it was a long, long, long pole. We asked her, "Are you sure you want to transport that bulky monstrosity in the car between us four women?" Yes, she wanted to take it. Needless to say, the entire ride back to Thousand Oaks, I had the birdhouse perch sticking into my cheek. It took a while, but I have forgiven her. Shirley was indeed a lovely woman, just like I perceived at our first meeting 62 years ago. I'm forever grateful that she was my dear friend. I love you, Shirley.
I think we should make the brothers come stand with us. case I can't finish. Thank you, Vivian. I have the letter from Bishop Brenda Boss, who is both the Bishop of Southwest California, although not technically my mom's bishop. Pastor or Bishop Jeff is my mom's bishop, as her membership is up in San Francisco, but down here it would be inappropriate for us to not recognize Bishop Brenda, and she is a friend of ours. So, dear friends and family of Saint Shirley Egerton, I am disappointed to not be with you today, remembering one of the great dames, M, of the Lutheran Church, our beloved Shirley. Not only did she raise a busload of fine Lutheran men, she accompanied one of our great bishops, the Reverend Paul, through his particular journey as churchman and educator. Shirley knew a lot of things, some rather remarkable, some especially grim. She was one of the great ones. I came to know and love Shirley late in her life story in the mid-2000s when she was being chauffeured around pride parades, waving to the adoring gaze, usually wearing a feather boa and being particularly fabulous. She was legend to me and to so many others. My favorite image of Shirley is a famous one, the photo from Churchwide Assembly in Indianapolis in 2001. No, Shirley and Bishop Paul Egerton were not photographed leading worship or casting ballots at the assembly. They were photographed being arrested during a peaceful protest of the event. They were part of a large group of people demonstrating their support for LGBTQ Lutherans, whose existence was being debated for the 400th time by the ELCA. Okay, maybe it wasn't the 400th time, but everyone who tells the story tells it that way. Still, Paul and Shirley were lending their voice and their bodies to the movement, calling for the inclusion of LGBTQ children of God in our church. They were not teenage hippies or what have you. They were dignified, well-respected leaders in the Lutheran Church, willingly getting arrested for a cause. I think about that photo. Lori said I could have tears, but no snot. Hey, thank you. I think about that photo and the acts of Lori and Bishop Paul a lot. For all the Egerton clan, I pray for you and can only imagine how great your loss is. Your mom was a remarkable woman, and I am glad you all had her in your life. Her memory is a blessing, and her love and work live on. Praise God for Shirley. With love and respect, Brenda. Brenda had a family function that was scheduled a long time ago and really wanted to be here. I just want to tell one story. I've got three here, so you can thank me later. But the not quite but soon to be elected U.S. House of Representatives from Santa Barbara, Dr. Walter Capps, who was a professor at University of California at San Bernardino. I think Jeff and I were at CLU at the same time. Excuse me, Bishop Jeff. I'm still getting used to it. When Dr. Capps came and spoke at Cal Lutheran, and I attended all his lectures, and he was relaying a story about his Christian faith, and he was talking about all of the people that had asked him about that, how ironic that was for a university professor, and all of the proofs for the existence of God. And one of his students asked him, but really, Dr. Capps, why is it that you still believe in God? And Dr. Capps said, well, I think really, to be honest with you, it was because of my mother. And the students were up in arms. Oh, that's outrageous. How could you use such a pathetic, mamsy-pamsy reason, rationale, for the existence of God? And Dr. Capps' answer was, well, you didn't know my mother. And I believe that's why I'm standing here as part of the team that said, yes, we will have a Lutheran worship service as a memorial service for Shirley Mae Smith Egertson. That's all I got.
I have 8 stories. And I'm not as gracious as Glenn, so you're going to hear them all. No, I'll edit. I'm Greg. I'm the oldest. Most of you know me. I do feel like I have an impossible task, speaking to you after Vivian and then after Glenn. It's an impossible task. But my nieces and nephews come next, and that would be even worse to have to follow them. So I do have an impossible task, but we all do, right? I've been thinking about this a lot, trying to figure out, what do you say at a memorial service when somebody you love as much as our mom, and somebody who loves us as much as she did, what do you say? Do you just look back and find fond memories? Do you choose some cherished moments? Do you tell secrets? That's always kind of fun. Or do you want to hear some funny stories? That's what I think people really want. I will actually edit them out, but I've got a couple of them. Any of you that ever came over to the house and Vivian referred to her creativity, my mom loved to decorate. She loved to decorate every corner of the house. There was, and there is, and some of you know what I'm talking about, there is no surface left uncovered, even the bathroom. There's, and it's nice stuff, but there's no room to put your razor or your shaving cream if you have to shave, and you can't move it out of the way because there's no place to put it either. She loves these little children's blocks, you know, the little children's blocks, and she has a set that spells Merry Christmas. She puts it on the top of the microwave, right, and nicely arranged so it looks like, well, the microwave vibrates a little bit, you know, every time you use it, and slowly but surely, every year, those blocks move a little closer to the edge as you do it, and eventually one of them falls into whatever you're cooking. I'd ask her about it, and she would just look at me. Yeah, so, you know, pull it out of your soup. She just wanted to make things pretty. I could go on, and I won't, just for length of time. But if any of you have fond memories of your mother's home hobbies, crafts, when you were young, anybody remember decoupage? Macrame? I remember 2 particular things. She once brought home this bag of big marbles. You think they were to give her sons as toys? No. It was the latest craze at church. You glue them together, you put a piece of driftwood on the end, and you've got a grape cluster for your coffee table. Who doesn't want one of those? And if you're really good, you bake it first, you put it in a cold water bath, it crackles on the inside so that it sparkles in the light. Now, sometimes it just shatters. But that's the cost of making things pretty, right? Another time I remember her asking my dad for a pair of tin snips and the needle nose pliers. Do you think that was to do a home repair? No. She'd take a tin can, cut it into really tiny little strips, and then with the needle nose plier, scroll up and make a Queen Anne chair. 4 legs and a back with the bottom of the can as the seat. And then you make a little cushion for the seat, you spray it with antique paint, and you've got a pin cushion for your sewing room. Again,
my mother, could take an empty tin can of soup and turn it into a functional piece of art. And she loved doing it. And she was really good at it. But more seriously, I do want to say, when I think about what I'm going to miss the most, obviously, I'm going to miss her as my mother, but I think I'm going to miss her friendship more at this point in my life. I've lived up in San Francisco for 40 years, but our center of our family life has always been down here. After my dad passed away in 2011, I started coming down more often. She started coming up more often. My friends, some of you are here, became her friends. And indeed, I suspect some of you like her more than you like me. What'll I miss the most? A couple of the traditions that she started after Dad died. Coming up to the city, we would always go to the symphony, San Francisco, on Christmas, around Christmas, look at the holiday decorations, have a glass of champagne. She loved to have a glass of champagne. We always had to sit on the left side during the concert because she wanted to be able to see the strings, but you couldn't sit too close because she wanted to see the double basses as well. And then somewhere during the concert, she'd lean over and whisper something interesting about the way they were bowing. Didn't mean anything to me. We had a number of other traditions that I won't go into, but the last one I will say that we were starting, the last one I will say that I'm gonna miss is her coming to my church, our church. She joined a couple of years ago, and Pastor B couldn't be here. She's out of the country, but she did, you'll notice in your program, a very nice letter and invitation. Both of my parents started attending St. Francis whenever they were in the area, and then after Dad died, obviously Mom came up more often. And there's no greater joy in my life that I could say at this point than watching her become part of that community, and that community becoming part of her. Part of that is because she loved San Francisco. She was born in San Francisco, and that's where she will be laid to rest finally on Sunday, May 5th. I looked it up this morning. St. Francis is a mile and a half from the house they were living in on Downey Street when she was born. So it is really going to be a kind of homegoing. So what more can I say? Well, I actually could, but to be honest, I need to say that I just feel an overwhelming sense of gratitude. Of course, for having her as my mom, but also for just knowing her at all. And most of all, and most recently, as a friend. I'll leave you with this. When we were going through her things, and we still are, we found a copy of the Youth Sings Praise book that it's filled with gospel songs, and she sang so often as a teenager, and we all remember from when we were growing up. She loved being Lutheran, but she never gave up her Baptist roots. I think she got the best of both. And there's a song called The Heart of God, written by Cleland McAfee, and I'll just read a couple of the verses. There is a place of quiet rest near to the heart of God. A place where sin cannot molest, near to the heart of God. O Jesus, blessed Redeemer, sent from the heart of God, hold us who wait before thee near to the heart of God. There is a place of comfort sweet near to the heart of God. There is a place where we, our Savior, meet near to the heart of God. There is a place of full release near to the heart of God. And a place where all is joy and peace, near to the heart of God. Near to the heart of God is where she always wanted to be. I believe that's where she came from. That is where she spent her life. And I believe that is where she is now. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm Sarah. I am one of the many grandchildren, and I have the pleasure of wearing her boa today. So when I was thinking about what I wanted to say, I was thinking about one of the first things you learn as a grandchild is the idea of legacy, because you are thrown into a large room with a lot of people you barely know, and you learn about their lives and their stories, and you learn what your family is made of, and you learn about the old times when you walk uphill to school both ways, and thinking about this a lot, Grandma was my last grandparent that was still alive. So it's been on my mind of what kind of history I have to make a future with. So when I think about Grandma's legacy, I think of two things mainly. The first thing is the big family that is taking up six rows today. I think about that I see all of my cousins as siblings and my uncles as fathers and my aunts as mothers. And I think about how we would have our family trips that would always kind of turn into Grandma's house, which we would spend a lot of time at too for any given holiday. It always reminds me of any given long summer day of watermelon and mini hot dogs and Jordan's tri-tip and the GameCube, wiffle ball, jacuzzi, the smell of eucalyptus and her wind chimes, and cigarettes. No one smoked cigarettes, but we went to Vegas a lot. So it's very nostalgic for me. And as I grow up and I talk to people and they say they don't have family members or parts of their family that they don't talk to anymore, I can't imagine that. And I know I have all of my thanks to Grandma and Grandpa for making being together the default. And I don't take that for granted. And the other thing I think about when I think about her legacy is that she was cool. She was really cool. A good amount of our the cousins have, you know, tattoos, piercings, and she loved them. She told me that my nose piercing was the one she wanted when she was young, and I always joked about getting matching tattoos with her. And a couple years ago, I shaved my head, and she thought it was so cool. She is the first person that will be unwaveringly supportive of whatever your life decisions may be. She's always there. And another part of that is what Glenn was talking about of her activism. It's quite the playground flex to say, my grandparents have been arrested, and give no other context than that. But it was such a cool legacy to hear about, and I was part of the Reconciling in Christ committee here at Holy Trinity, it was really important to me. I talked about it like in my college applications of just how important it is to find dreams and hopes of real people in your life, and that's what Grandma was to me. And starting around last year, I started, this is gonna be the first time most of you hear this, but I feel comfortable coming out as bisexual. One memory I have with her that I would like to share with you is the last time I visited Grandma. I wanted to tell her, and I did. And I just thanked her for creating a family where that's something you want to say. And if you had a heart-to-heart with her at any point, you know the look she gives you. And she wasn't really speaking at the time, but you could just tell. So I just wanted to share that it never ended.
Hello, I am Marie. I am one of her granddaughters. And my theme today is going to be how she kind of carried a legacy because she loved to help people. Truly lived up to the definition of a grandma. Like, she made sure that you just had, like, anyone over, they were family, no matter who they were. And her hugs, always so comforting, just a hug of home, and she really made sure you were not hungry, like, ever. Even if you were full, she'd still be nudging a bowl of something towards you, like, just in case. Her main go-to foods that I always love, I mean, it was cinnamon and sugar toast, always bacon in the morning, and ramen. And whenever she gave you these foods, she had her lap tray with it, and you never were supposed to get up. You got to stay comfy and just eat your food and just be there with grandma. This is one of the many just examples of her actions to show how much she liked to help and care for people. She raised a big family, as mentioned very much before, and continued with cousins and everyone else. Shirley worked at a preschool as well, and some of us attended. I, for one, was ready to fight for her lap during story time. She helped teach me the kind gift of sharing, because she would sometimes tell me, no, this other kid has a turn, and yeah, it was a hard lesson that day. Grandma opened her a house, an attic to family members, whether it was for in need, for comfort, or to save a lot of money because you're a broke college student. And she would always be supportive. In middle school, she helped teach me so many skills while I was learning the violin, including tuning by ear. And she was always there for my art. She helped me be as skilled as I am today. And she also helped with, you know, all these things, but including transportation and babysitting. So there is this one time, this always sticks out to me no matter what. She was picking me up from wherever we were, and as we're driving home, it was a torrential downpour. Like, similar to the rains that we've been having recently, you could barely see 5 feet in front of you. The windshield wipers could not wipe fast enough. And instead of feeling scared, instead of feeling like, oh my gosh, we're gonna crash, I felt safe thanks to her. So safe that I started laughing uncontrollably. I was doubled down, crying, and having just those laughter cramps. And that car she drove me in is mine today. And so every time when it rains, it's such a great reminder. Shirley helped us move forward, face our fears, build confidence, and most importantly, taught us how to help others. It is such a privilege for me to have Shirley as my grandma. After all, I could have been bought into a different family.
Marie told us she wouldn't make that joke. I'm actually glad you did. hi, everybody. I'm Alex. Greg told me yesterday that he was only going to talk for a minute, and I could have three of his minutes. And then he told eight stories. So, but I'm not going to cut mine down at all, because I'm at Grandma Shirley's memorial, and I think of a couple things when I think of Grandma. I feel a great sense of pride that Sarah touched on a lot of those things, a pride of what Grandma stood for, what she did, who she was, how she loved. But I also think of a lot of chatter, a lot of long dinners. I think of a lot of talking. So when my uncle said, you got to keep this to 2 to 3 minutes, I thought, there's no way in hell that Grandma Shirley, if you want to honor Grandma Shirley, you better blabber on and on and on. To do this in Grandma Shirley's style, I can't even begin to try. But just so you know, if you didn't, if Grandma was asked to talk about anything, the first 5 minutes minimum, you're not even getting to the topic yet. You're only getting the background characters. You're getting the history. A simple question like, hey, how'd you and Grandpa meet? You didn't even hear Paul or Shirley's name mentioned in that first 5 minutes. It was just what church it was at, and then the flowers were arranged by so-and-so, and like you, all these little details, and her creative eye and things like that, I think just she saw those things, and she made sure they were a part of everything. In all seriousness, though, I did really love listening to Grandma talk. It was often said as kind of an annoyance. Grandma will go on, you'll go to dinner, and you'll order the food, and the waiter will bring the food as you're rounding first, and then Grandma will have her first bite about 30 minutes into the meal, and then she'll say, oh darn, it got cold, I need a box, but she just was spending too much time talking. But even though she liked to talk, Grandma often, or didn't often, give advice, certainly not unsolicited advice, and I think it was because she was so accepting of who everyone was, who we as grandkids are. And when you have so many, I don't even know how many grandkids, when you have so many grandkids, I think it'd be really easy to just kind of be one thing to all of them, but she was her own unique self to each of us, and in not giving advice, she was accepting who we were and how we wanted to do things. But the couple times she did give me advice, there was the one time in 2016, during the election, she loved her news and MSNBC, and I was in college, and I was actually her roommate at the time. I lived above her in the little apartment attic above her house, and we were both really excited for the election. You know, it was very important to Grandma that she would see a woman president in her lifetime, and spoiler alert, that didn't happen. So I was throwing a party at my place, also thinking we were going to celebrate something, but when it became clear that the orange man was going to win, I came downstairs and checked in on Grandma. And Grandma, to my surprise, was actually pretty good. We had a nice little hug. It was all good, and you know, it wasn't anything out of the mill. Carried on with our evening. And I went upstairs where I had a little gathering of people. And she must have sensed something borderline on fear in my eyes or something. I'm not sure what. But her grandma's senses were tingling. And I kid you not, in the 2 years I lived up there, she never once walked upstairs to see me. She respected my privacy. She just like, I don't want to cross that boundary with my 21-year-old grandson, I guess. I don't know what it was. But tonight, as shy as she was with all of these people, all these 20-year-olds up there, she just knew she had something to say. So she walked up the stairs. She knocked on the door. And I said, Grandma, what are you doing up here? You've literally never been up here. This is your own house. What are you doing up here? And she gave a little sermon that I think only Grandma could have given. And she told most of my unsuspecting friends that we needed to trust God and we needed to hold on to each other and that we had been through hard times before and we would be in them again, but that it was going to be okay. And then she gave everyone a hug and she left. The one other time she gave me advice that I'll really treasure was that she told me that when I find the person I want to marry, that the criteria is that you should be able to talk to that person. Nothing else, just you have to find someone you need to talk to. She didn't say you need to get along with them. And in fact, she said, I often didn't get along with Grandpa Paul. But she said that you have to talk to him. When I did move upstairs, when I lived with her, that idea was created by Grandpa Paul, I believe. And his idea was that I would live there and I would pay rent by cleaning the pool, which is very Grandpa Paul. Why, you know, you don't need to make money off of your grandkid by charging him rent, but you can at least save a little money by firing the pool guy. But that was a few years before I actually moved in. Grandpa died when I was about 16. And so when I moved in at 20, I only had Grandma as a landlord. And so I went to Grandma and I said, okay, I'm ready to start cleaning the pool. And she's like, what pool? What are you talking about? And I said, you have a pool in your backyard, Grandma. She was always out there sunbathing, but she was never in the pool. I don't think I ever saw her swim. But I'm ready to clean the pool. What can I do? Yeah, let me start. Did you fire the guy yet? And she said, we're not going to fire the pool guy. I like him. I said, well, what can I do to show my gratitude? I'm living here for free. This has really helped me out. And she said, I'll take you to dinner once a week. Mind you, I was already going to like the family Tuesday night Pacific Fresh dinners, so this was going to be a second dinner that she was offering to pay for. And what I love about this now is it just really shows a little window into what she valued so much. And that's Grandma Shirley knew that quality time was more important than anything. And she knew that connecting wasn't something that was just going to happen. And Grandma was always there even when I was little, but I really got to know her when I was an adult, and it was because of that time that she set aside and so graciously gave to me. And her favorite way, of course, was to cultivate that connection over wine and dinner. I just feel so blessed and proud to be here. Thank you all for coming.
The Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer because the servant does not know what the master is doing, but I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Thank you to Holy Trinity Lutheran Church of Thousand Oaks, a Reconciling in Christ congregation of the Southwest California Synod of the ELCA, and your pastor Eric Gaynor and staff for your holy hospitality. It seems we were just here to gather and give thanks for Bishop Emeritus J. Roger Anderson. So bless you for once again welcoming another grieving and grateful assembly to your space this day for this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Siblings in Christ, family of Shirley and family in Shirley, grace to you and peace from the God whose yes is always and forever, from Christ crucified and risen from the dead, and from the Spirit who intercedes for us with sighs too deep for words. Amen. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Easter came early for Shirley. In the early days of Lent, with the lights on her Christmas trees, plural, still twinkling, and with her countless QVC candles burning in every corner, proclaiming the light that shines in the darkness, which not even the darkness of death can overcome, Shirley passed over from death into eternal life, surrounded by her beloved family who tended to her every need to the end with the same fiercely gentle love with which she loved you. No longer able to speak, she, I think, would have me say to you here and now, thank you for your tender care. Thank you for your most attentive love. Thank you for gently accompanying her to the door. Just like the Christmas wreaths that still adorned her front door, the risen one was waiting at the door, along with Paul and all her beloved. Easter came early. Your mom, your grandma, your great-grandmother, your sister, your mother-in-law, your friend, our dear Shirley Mae Smith, was baptized on Easter morning, which way back in 1945 fell on April 9th, just 3 days from now, when she was 8 going on 9. She was what might be called a pre-Lutheran, a little Baptist girl in Glendale who had most certainly by that time been singing and playing her violin in praise of her risen Lord and Savior. Of course Shirley was baptized on Easter. It all makes sense now. Her whole life pulsated and effervesced with the risen life that was and is hers and is yours, mine, and ours in Christ's death and resurrection. The words spoken at the beginning of this service are still resounding on this first Saturday of Eastertide. In her baptism, Shirley was clothed with Christ. In the day of Christ's coming, she shall be clothed with glory. Clothed with Christ, yes, but oh, how Shirley could accessorize. It was her charism to show up and sparkle. Yes, it was primarily the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, which she exuded, of course. But the beauty inside and out, that eternal and enduring smile, along with her unique flair and panache that was her signature, even when her primary accessory that one day was a zip-tie handcuff after being arrested with Paul and others at a church-wide assembly for peacefully demonstrating the ELCA's unjust policies. But the year we asked her to accessorize with the crown and gown of Glinda, the Good Witch of the North, for the Pride Parade was almost too much for her to bear. Her hair had been coiffed just so, her outfit flawless as usual and always, but nevertheless, Shirley consented, and nevertheless, she persisted in her elegant authenticity. Truth be told, that year she totally took one for the team. She really did. Glinda, or rather Shirley, was just that good. One of my first memories of Shirley was back when I was a young and impressionable pastor, newly transplanted from the Midwest via Divinity School on the East Coast. Shirley and Paul were local hosts for all of the 65 of the ELCA's bishops and their spouses, who back in the day were all wives except for one. It was probably 95 or 96, and it was January or February, and it was the Woodland Hills Marriott. And I don't really know why I was there. I think maybe I was fangirling for Shirley. Shirley and all the bishop's spouses, except for one, Judd Larson, Bishop April's husband, were out sunbathing by the pool when I walked past from an inside corridor. And there was Shirley, looking 100% SoCal, tan and glam, holding court from her chaise lounge amid all the other pale and peaked Lutheran bishops' wives from somewhere east of here. And she was a sight to behold, the quintessential, luminescent California mom who us pious, rural, awkward, Midwestern Lutheran kids could only imagine existed. No wonder even the young and robust Paul Wenis Egertson, once simply a gangly pastor wannabe, had to woo her and win her over. Which is why Shirley made such a hit riding in the Gay Pride Parade every year down Santa Monica Boulevard in the heart of West Hollywood, which, by the way, was often done with Judy Garland singing Somewhere Over the Rainbow from the Wizard of Oz soundtrack on repeat for the entire parade route in our red rental convertible. Shirley was the church and P-flag and the PTA all wrapped up in her signature boa, and I heard their voices as I drove Paul and Shirley, and later just Shirley with Greg riding shotgun down that 2-mile parade route. Happy Pride, Shirley. Thanks, Shirley. We love you, Shirley, lots of those. But this one, we're proud of you, Shirley. We're proud of you. For all of us who had fled the tyranny of keeping secrets and keeping up appearances and had moved to the margins of the country to be our authentic selves, we needed our mom. and we were proud that in Shirley we had one. Mind you, this all started before policy change in the ELCA with regard to its partnered LGBTQIA clergy, before all those letters were even a thing, long before gay marriage was a reality, way before pride practically has become a given for bishops and spouses to participate in. Before all that, Shirley and Paul rode. And did they shine? He in his purple shirt with rainbow stole, and Shirley predictably in pink with a rainbow boa. This photo has rested on my desk for soon to be 30 years. I'll bring it to the reception. You can have a closer look. Reminding me that without their courage, without their love and support, I certainly wouldn't be the one standing here preaching today. Nor might I add, Bishop Jeff, would you likely be presiding here or anywhere else for that matter. Nor would we have heard greetings from a Bishop Brenda Boss, the first lesbian bishop in the ELCA, nor would you, Bishop Dean, have had such shoulders to stand on to equip you to so boldly take us the rest of the way? Nor would this synod have gone on to elect the first openly gay bishop in the ELCA, now a seminary president, the Reverend Dr. Guy Irwin. As Bishop Paul wrote in the acknowledgement section of his doctoral dissertation, quote, "Always first and often last, there is my wife Shirley, who gave more than all the others in this effort and never seemed to notice. What language can I borrow to thank thee, dearest friend?" End quote. What language could we borrow this day? Shirley would point us to the words of Scripture from Micah chapter 6, which were her essence, so much so that she had tucked in her dresser drawer the artwork that you see on the back cover of the service folder, reminding us to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with God. It was her essence, the essential, surely. Then there was her resonance. Her resonance was in the words of St. Paul to the Romans, which contain her favorite verse of Scripture to which she would point us today. We know, Romans 8:28, we know that all things work together for good. All things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to God's purpose. There's that word good again, as we heard in the first reading. All things work together for good, and the Lord has told you, O mortal, what is good. As we act justly, as we love tenderly, and as we walk humbly, then I think, as Shirley's grandchildren and their generation would say these days, it's all good. Finally, there is Shirley's pièce de résistance in the words of the gospel today, proclaimed by Pastor George Johnson at Paul's memorial in 2011. Jesus says, "Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing." The repeating words throughout the reading are abide and bear fruit, because as Shirley's life and legacy attests, when you abide, when you remain, when you continue, when you keep on keeping on in Christ, you bear fruit. It happens, it just happens, and the fruit of abiding, the chief fruit of all the nine fruits of the Holy Spirit, if you haven't thought about them or heard of them recently, let this fruit remind you. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. The chief of those, the first mentioned, is love. Abide. Bear fruit. Love. There were women at the empty tomb on that first Easter morning. They were the first eyewitnesses of the resurrection, of resurrection reality. They were the first of many women throughout the next two millennia to give witness to Jesus, the risen one, and to live the risen life. The Shirley legacy, if you will, living life in resurrection reality. Now passed on to you, now passed on to us. Baptized on Easter, with Christmas always in her heart, and ever poised for the Pentecostal pride ride. Easter came early for Shirley. But remember, this is not the first time Shirley has died. For in the waters of baptism, Shirley died, was buried, and raised with Christ. And because Christ lives, Shirley lives. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed.
Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty God, in holy baptism, you have knit your chosen people together into one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. God of mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give courage and faith to all who mourn, and a sure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. God of mercy, grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. God of mercy, help us in the midst of things we cannot understand to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of life everlasting. God of mercy,
hear our prayer. God of all grace, we give you thanks that because of his death, our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed the power of death. And by his resurrection, he opened the kingdom of heaven to all. Make us certain that because Christ lives, we shall also live, that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The peace of the risen Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please, as you are able, stand and turn and offer a sign of Christ's peace. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Indeed, it is right, a joyful thing, that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who rose from the dead and in whom our hope of resurrection dawns. The sting of death has been removed by the glorious promise of his risen life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with cherubim and seraphim, with the church on earth, the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy God, you alone are holy, you alone are God. The universe declares your praise. Beyond the stars, beneath the sea, within every cell, with each breath, we praise you, O God. Generations bless your faithfulness through the water, by night and day, across the wilderness, out of exile, into the future. We bless you. We give you thanks for your dear child at the heart of human life, near to those who suffer, beside the sinner among the poor, with us now. We thank you, O God. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Savior Christ took bread, broke it, and gave it to friends and disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." At the same time, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Remembering his love for us on the way, at the table, and to the end, we proclaim this day the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We pray for the gift of your Spirit in our gathering, within this meal, among your people, throughout the world. With Shirley May and all your holy ones, of all times and places, we offer our blessing, praise, and thanksgiving to you, Holy God, through Christ Jesus, by your Spirit, in your church, without end. Amen. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus teaches us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done. The gifts of God for the whole people of God. Amen. You may be seated. Let nothing separate you from the love of God. Let nothing separate you from the love of God offered at this table. All are welcome in this place as you are drawn to the table. All are welcome. You can come for a blessing. You can come to receive bread, the body of Christ. You can come to receive wine or grape juice. Wine is light colored. Grape juice is dark colored. The blood of Christ. There are gluten-free options also available. Come.
Thank you. smile, though your heart is aching. Smile even though it's breaking.
arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen.
Remember that this is not the first time Shirley has died. For in the waters of baptism, Shirley died, was buried, and raised with Jesus Christ. Because Christ lives, Shirley lives.
Thanks be to God.
Receive a blessing. May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Savior Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do God's will, working in you that which is pleasing in God's sight. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen. And the blessing of Almighty God, Creator, Redeemer, and Comforter, be with you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen.